Today I'm taking a look at a video from Will Kemp Art School called Basic Acrylic Color Mixing, How to Mix a Perfect Purple, Part 2 of 2, as an example of color bias theory, also known as the split primary palette. And I'll be showing you some of the problems with this widely accepted color mixing method. This video has been around a long time and has accumulated lots of views. Kemp's previous video, Part 1, is about mixing pinks, and demonstrates the so-called color bias of various reds. In part 2, he mixes 4 of those reds with 2 blues laid out in a grid for comparison, which is actually a great way to determine how best to mix bright purples, but only if you correctly interpret your results. So Kemp, being a proponent of color bias theory, describes various reds as having either an orange or a blue bias, and blues as having either a red or a green bias, which, by the way, he claims is due to impurities. Here are his blues with their biases, and from the previous video, here are his reds: cadmium red light, permanent alizarin crimson hue, and quinacridone red. So this is the basic layout. What would a split primary theorist like Will Kemp expect to happen when he makes these mixtures? He would expect that purple, because it lies between red and blue, is best made with a red-biased blue and a blue-biased red. That if he uses the orange-biased red or the green-biased blue, he will have complements muting each other, making mud. And that if he uses both orange-biased red and green biased blue, he might get an even darker, more muted color. So let's see what happens. Kemp starts by making a mixture of phthalo blue and quinacridone red, predicting that the green undertone in the phthalo blue will mute the color down when mixed with red. Just a minute. Do you see that beautiful purple in there? The crazy thing about this video is that you can actually see that phthalo blue and quinacridone red have made the most gorgeous bright violet if only Kemp would scrape away all that excess blue. The trouble is, phthalo blue has enormous tinting strength, and it's very easy to overdo it. You really have to use tiny, tiny amounts when it comes to this pigment. So then he goes on to mix quinacridone red with ultramarine blue, commenting on how much brighter that mixture is compared to the one below it. But is it brighter? The difference is really in hue, not saturation. The bottom one contains a lot of excess blue, the top one excess pink. But both colors are pretty vivid. And if we back up a bit, we can see that if only Kemp had scraped away all that excess quinacridone red, the purple he could have made with ultramarine is very similar to the purple he could have made with phthalo. Here are the two shots side by side for comparison. Sorry, these screenshots are a bit blurry. So then I decided to desaturate the image, except for two small spots that are similar in hue and value, so that you can really compare the saturation. And you can see they're both pretty bright. So what does Kemp have to say? He doesn't seem to notice what's happening before his own eyes. He says, as you can see, a red biased blue mixed with a blue biased red are always going to mix the brightest purple. Well, what I see is that both blues have produced gray when mixed with cadmium red, and both have made saturated colors when mixed with quinacridone red. Something like this. Kemp might have seen this had he put less phthalo in one mixture and more ultramarine in the other. You really have to match up your hues and values if you want to make an accurate comparison of saturation. Speaking of bias, it can be hard to see the truth when you think you know what's going to happen, which is called confirmation bias. So in conclusion, it seems that red, not blue, is the real problem when it comes to mixing bright purples. But why is that? Why would it be one way for red and a different way for blue? Here's a nice little triangle to help us understand an updated color theory. Let's assume that cyan, magenta, and yellow are better paint primaries. After all, your home printer seems to think it can do a pretty good job reproducing all colors with only these three inks. Let's also assume that red, green, and blue are secondaries. After all, the red, green, and blue shown here really were made by mixing the cyan, magenta, and yellow shown here. And in the middle, let's put some mud, because after all, if we mix any two complements, or any two secondaries, or all three primaries, we know that the result will trend toward gray or black, right? So our goal is to mix a reasonably saturated purple or violet, the color between blue and magenta. And if we draw a straight line to represent a mixture between blue and magenta, we see that it doesn't go into the mud. And the same goes for a line between cyan and magenta. This means that we should be able to mix a good bright purple by mixing magenta with either blue or cyan. On the other hand, a line between red and blue does cross through the mud, so we know that any purple we might make from those two colors will be dark. And the same goes for red and cyan, which are complements, by the way. So this is where color bias theorists miss the mark. First, they stick with the tradition of red, yellow, and blue instead of adopting cyan, magenta, yellow. And second, when their red, yellow, and blue don't do a good job, then they come up with stories about contamination,